whispers in my ears this morning to keep the service rolling in order to get up the street for strawberries. So I'll do my very best to do that. But welcome, everybody. Thank you for being here this morning as we are still traveling through the Easter season. And we begin our service at the top of page one. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open,
all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will come no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Words back on the topic of love, and that's a know, from time to time, Jesus gets us to think about it, just because we have such a hard time doing certain things, especially loving. What does love mean? What does love mean as it is portrayed in the Bible? But, you know, go out and love one another. You know, there are just some people that are hard to love. Some people are very difficult to love. I'll say that as a priest, I won't lie, there are some people that are just hard to love. But we still have this biblical imperative, this commandment from God to go love one another, right? Jesus, who is probably the picture of infinite, immeasurable, wonderful love himself, as he was kneeling down at the feet of the disciples. You know, our gospel, if you rewind the tape a little bit, we're back at the Last Supper. And as he's washing their feet, he knows in his mind, I'm washing your feet, and you're going to be the one who's about to walk down and betray me. I'm washing your feet, Peter, and I know that in just a few hours you're going to deny me 3 times. But still, he's on his knees serving and loving these people to the very end. When, you know, it comes to doing surveys and studies, there are lots of groups and lots of money spent on measuring all kinds of metrics, all kinds of numbers about growth of this and changes in there. And church is no different. There's a group out in California that I've crossed paths with a couple times over the years. It's called the Barna Group, and they do all kinds of measuring when it comes to church growth and things. And perhaps one of the two biggest reasons, not necessarily using the word, but one in that list of like top 10 reasons why people don't go to church anymore. First reason often comes up is that people, especially millennials, our younger members, look at people in the church and think that we're a bunch of hypocrites, that we're preaching the love message, we're saying the love stuff, we're, you know, love. We're having our little kumbaya moment here in church. But then we go outside and we treat each other so badly, so poorly. So between leadership and membership, it is seen as there's a big disconnect when we're hypocrites. Second reason, believe it or not, is that people, especially millennials, perceive that there's really a very, in many places, many churches, there is not a sense of community. Sense of community, sense of fellowship. I know that here, I feel that we have a strong sense of community, but the downside to that is that I've gotten some feedback from some newcomers over the past couple of years, is that we all love each other so much that it feels like it's hard to break in. It's hard to break into the circle. Because there's such a sense of tight community that, well, there's no room for me to get in there. Right? Some of the feedback I've received from people. So something just to be aware of. When you check your emails, how many of us, you know, before you get to the real important stuff, there's just tons of spam, tons of garbage. I have an email address that's not very many people, you know, I use it for church email address. You think church business, but somehow it's latched on and I've gotten all kinds of garbage from everywhere. In it this week, I got an email that was trying to promote a book, and I won't mention the denomination, but a book for the membership in order to find a way to defend the faith and defend the church. You know, against what people are wrongly saying historically, about their doctrine, their teaching. And it is a book purely guiding people to get the right answers so that they can defend the church. I think God can probably defend the church. But look at your front covers for just a minute. And I've got a color picture of this in the bulletin, in the newsletter this week. But you know, I think so many of us in the Christian world, in the churches, we're spending so much time making sure that people are following the rules, that we're defending the rules. You know, this is what it means to be an insider. You know, and if you're not following the rules, I'm going to come hammer you for it, if you're going to be a true member of the church. Or the theology, our ideology, the theology, how we understand what we say about God, and so forth and so on. And of course, you can't tell because it's a black and white copy, but there's a big red X through it. That shouldn't we as the church help people first find God and then also find how to love each other as opposed also worrying about making sure that you know how to tell people how to follow rules?
Right.
I thought that was really kind of timely because, you know, Jesus nowhere says this is what it takes to be a good Episcopalian. This is nowhere where it takes to you know, if you do this, then, because half the time people are coming to him and he's breaking the rules himself, right? At least the rules of the time. In order to what? Love one another. So, what kind of love are we talking about? We're talking about a sacrificial kind of love. Sacrifice means to give up one good thing in order to have another good thing. You know, I can't be in two places at once, but I'm going to have to make a decision which is the more important, more beneficial thing that we're doing sometimes. Probably the best story I've ever heard of true sacrificial giving. My wife would be happy with this story because it takes place in Wales and she's Welsh. And but it was this woman, and I didn't think Wales really ever got that much snow. But evidently there was a big snowstorm. This woman was carrying her infant baby and it's fine. And as she was walking along, she realized that she was not going to make it to the next village in safety. There was no one there to rescue her. So she took off her outer garments and coat and bundled around the baby and then kind of put the baby on the ground and huddled over on top of the baby. They found her. She had passed. She had died. But much to everybody's surprise, the baby had lived because she had not only wrapped the baby up so well, but she was protecting the baby with her body. I'm not sure that we're called to go out today and go and lay down in life. I'm not sure that that's what we're being called to do today. I don't know. But there are so many ways in which we can love people, especially those people we don't necessarily like. By simply the good that we do. We're in this cycle right now where we're reading an awful lot of the book of Revelation. Let's just face it, it's a crazy sounding book. It really is. It sounds like someone's on magic mushrooms. But what the point of the story is, where it's leading to, is the fact that it sets before us a picture of the ideal perfect world, which we call heaven. That when God's kingdom is fully established, fully in place, this is what the world is going to be like, and this is what your life is going to be like there. With no more pain, no more crying, no more thirst, no more frustration, no more mourning, no more death, no more of that stuff that we dread. And you're saying, well, that's well and good. We'll get to that point someday, maybe, and we'll get to heaven. But what the book of Revelation is trying to impress upon us is that we can begin to have the kingdom of God, that taste of that heaven here on earth now, before we get there. And that happens by every good deed, every act of kindness, every act of love, no matter, it's easy to love a friend. It's not so easy to do something good for people that we don't like. But every one of those acts of love and kindness brings that kingdom of God more present here and now. Right now. So we hear these stories of love over and over. Love your neighbor. Love one another. Love as God has loved you. And you say, oh, okay, another love story. Another love story. I think until we really get it right, until we really finally put it into full practice, we need to hear this story. Because we need to treat each other better. We need to build the community to be what it really is meant to be. And when we do that, we're building the kingdom at the same time. One life at a time, one good deed at a time. One, I'm going to help my neighbor that I don't like. No, and that's hard to do. Hard to do. But as I draw this to a close, let us pray. Gracious and loving Father, we give you thanks for this incredible day. And in it, you've given us the opportunity to help build your kingdom here on earth through what seems to be a random, meaningless, little kind of act. Every one of those little acts builds like a brick, one on top of another, builds the building of your kingdom. Help us to be aware of those in need around us. Help us to use the gifts you've given us to help those people. And in helping them, we are helping ourselves to create the more perfect community of your kingdom, your honor. In your name we pray. Amen.
Now, if you will please join me as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life of the rest.
Prayers of the people follow on page 7. Because God has been glorified in Jesus, let us pray for all those who God loves in the name of Jesus, saying,
Hallelujah, Lord, hear our prayer.
For the church, especially for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Marianne and Chilton, our bishops, all the people and parishes of the Diocese of Washington, and for Chris, our priest, we pray that being strengthened by the risen Christ, we may be strong in our faith and bear witness to his commandment of love.
Hallelujah. Lord, hear our prayer.
For this parish family, that we may be known as disciples of Jesus by the love and care that we show one another.
Hallelujah. Lord, hear our prayers.
For people of all faiths who are experiencing persecutions and hardships, that God will protect them, fill them with courage, and help them to love in the face of fear.
Hallelujah. Lord, hear our prayers.
For all whose work points to a new heaven and a new earth, especially those who fight poverty, homelessness, and hunger, God's light and love will shine through their service and be a sign of hope for all.
Hallelujah. Lord, hear our prayer.
For the elderly and the homebound, the sick and the suffering, remembering especially those on our prayer list and others, we pray that God will renew them and give them a taste of the water of life.
Hallelujah. Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died,
we especially remember Bob Whitlock.
May they find a place in the new and eternal Jerusalem where death is no more.
Hallelujah. Lord, hear our prayer.
Lifting our voices with all creation, Mary the God-bearer, and all the saints who have borne witness to the risen Christ, let us offer ourselves and one another to the living God through Christ.
Hallelujah. To you, O Lord, we give praise and glory.
Blessed
are you, God of glory, who gave us your Son. Hear the prayers we offer on behalf of your whole creation and strengthen it in your love, that we may honor your Spirit, which fills the whole earth, through Jesus Christ our Savior.
celebrate festival, but right after the service, for those folks that are still busy working, I'm going to take communion up to them so that they can receive communion from our service. So we're going to break 100 again. The first thing I want to do is I want to send off my best wishes to Diana. I want to, your father just passed this past week, and his service will be on Tuesday at 1 o'clock at the Charleston in Waldo. So, but on behalf of the parish, I want to send our greetings to you and Dan as you experience this loss. So hopefully you'll feel the love of the local parish around you as you continue to meet the days again. The only big announcement, of course, is what's going to happen in a few minutes if I only shut up and get us moving again, is the Strawberry Festival. Big event. We raise money for great causes, great charities. You know, it's hard for a parish to do the good work these groups do, but we can give them money so that they can do their good work. So, by extension, we're doing good work in a way. But thank you in advance, especially to Shelby Opperman being our chair. And, for all of you who baked and made pies and schlepped tables and put up tents and all kinds of other good work, get chocolate, strawberries and chocolate. So, thank you for that very much. I think that's it. I think that's all I need to say. Is there anything else for the good of the order? We'll be here getting, we'll be signing a sign-up sheet next week for our year-end picnic for the Friday Night Fellowship. That'll be on May 31st, Friday, May 31st, behind the rectory. So stay tuned for that. We're coming up this week. You all don't have your other halves, but we send our birthday blessings to Joe. Joe's birthday is coming up this week, so we pray for you. And Marie, where did we go?
She went to the hall.
Oh!
No.
And bless her for
anniversary.
Oh, bless her later. Fred, will you wait until Pat's here with you? We're going to give you your blessing now. Okay, that's what I thought you would say, but I didn't. I think some of them say, well, you can bless him. So, okay. Friends, it's good to be together. It's good to be here, even with our four-legged friends. We give thanks to God for all that we can do in His holy name. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave Himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
we bow to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death. And by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. And therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of your name. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on them in your heart by faith in thanksgiving.
Thank you. Thank you.
Amen.